been surprised at where this road had taken him. 'Cause never in a million lives would he have dreamed of Bethlehem. And standing at the manger, he saw with his own eyes the message from the angels come to life. And Joseph said, "Why me? I'm just a simple man of trade. Why him with all the rulers in the world? Why here inside this stable filled with hay? Why her? She's just an ordinary girl." Now I'm not one to second guess what angels have to say, but this is such a strange way to say. To think of how it could have been if Jesus had come as he deserved, there would have been no Bethlehem, no lowly shepherds at his birth. But Joseph knew the reason love had to reach so far, and as he held the Savior in his arms, he must have thought, "Why me? I'm just a simple man of trade. Why him with all the rulers in this world? Why here inside this stable filled with hay? Why her? She's just an ordinary girl.
To second guess what person that would have been king if we had had a king and the royalty that goes with it. And came down to a McDonald's in San Antonio, Texas. And a man by the name of Paul Washington would have been the king if they had followed through. And it turns out that Paul Washington's son and grandson went to this pastor's church. And so he asked Paul, why did your ancestor choose not to be called king? And the pastor said, I was surprised when they told me. He said, they had an instant answer. It seems that when George Washington was offered the kingship, or offered the opportunity to be called a king, that he refused because of the history of our country, of how people had come and sought freedom from the authority of kings. And so when George Washington was offered that opportunity, he refused it because of the freedom that the people had and sought from being under the rule of kings. And the committee that had spoken to Washington and had talked with him, and as they drafted the Constitution and all that, they had a statement that they followed as they were meeting in committee. And that statement said, no king but King Jesus. The children of Israel had rebelled against God, and they wanted a king to be like all of the other nations. They got a king by the name of Saul, who was quickly denounced as king by God because of his impatience, because of his assuming authority that he did not have. And God chose another man to be king. That man was David. David became a man after God's own heart. David ruled and conquered the land that God had promised to his children when they left the land of Egypt. And David was a magnificent king. He was a king of kings. He did not mistreat his people. He did not abuse his people, but he protected his people and he cared for them. Yes, he made a mistake, but God said to David, David, I am going to raise up from you another king who is going to reign eternally. And from that time forward, the people of God, the people of Israel looked for that coming king. Solomon was not that king. Rehoboam was not that king. Jeroboam was not that king. And you come all the way down from the time of Solomon and the split of the kingdom to the present in 722 BC. The kingdom of Israel, that northern kingdom of 10 tribes, was a kingdom that had been full of disgrace. The kings that ruled were all kings that went after false gods, that went after and erected idols and other things. The last king of Israel was named Hoshea. He was taxed by the Assyrians. And in 722 B.C., Sennacherib, the king of Assyria, came, and as a result of the rebellion of Hoshea against him, Sennacherib destroyed the capital city of Samaria and took the people of the kingdom of Israel captive. When he took the people of Israel back into the land of Assyria and dispersed them throughout the rest of the kingdoms that he had, God broke forth against Sennacherib. And things occurred, and idols fell, and God made his presence known, and Sennacherib decided, hey, the God of Israel that I defeated is now attacking me, and I've got to do something else. And so he sent people back into Samaria. And those people that returned to Samaria, along with the foreign nations that went in, became the Samaritan people. But Sennacherib was not happy with just destroying Israel. Sennacherib went on down after he left Samaria, and he got right up to the border of Judah and the city of Jerusalem. He has the city of Jerusalem surrounded, and he calls out and calls out to the people in the city of Jerusalem who are on the walls of the city looking down. And Sennacherib sends messengers to a king by the name of Hezekiah. He is the king of Judah. And Sennacherib says to Hezekiah, look, my gods have defeated your God. I am here, and I am going to defeat your God the same way as I defeated him in Israel at Samaria. He didn't recognize the difference between the gods, but he said, I'm going to defeat your God. Your God cannot stand up to me. I want you to look at history. I want you to look, Hezekiah, at the lands that I have captured. I want you to look at all of the gods of those lands, and I want you to see that not one of those gods was able to stand up to me. I'm coming. Don't try to fight. Surrender. He sent a letter containing all of that information to Hezekiah. But not only did he do that, but he had one of his men from his army that could speak the language of Judah. And that man stood before the people who were lining the walls of Jerusalem. And that man cried out and said exactly the same thing to the people of Jerusalem. He said to them in their language so that they understood, why are you letting your king lead you into defeat? We are going to defeat your God. Surrender. Have your king surrender, and we won't kill you all. Sennacherib was a brave man. Also a foolish man. Because he wasn't attacking Judah. He was attacking Judah's God. Hezekiah had a prophet that was with him. A prophet by the name of Isaiah. And Hezekiah went to Isaiah and says, you've heard what's been said. What are we going to do? And Isaiah said to his king, trust God. Simply trust God. And let him deal with Sennacherib. And so Hezekiah went into the temple before God, and he opened the letter that he had received from Sennacherib. And he bowed down in prayer and said, God, here is what this king has said about you. Deal with it. We trust you. You are our God, and this foreign king is attacking you as he attacks your people. And in answer to his prayer, God says to Isaiah, to him through Isaiah, you won't have to lift a finger. You won't have to fight this man, for I am going to fight for my name. And that night, the soldiers of the army, the greatest army in the world at that time, the soldiers of the army of the king of Assyria went to sleep in their tents, surrounding the city of Jerusalem, awaiting the word to attack. And as they slept, the angel of God came into their midst, and 185,000 men died in their sleep. God fights for his name. God stands between his people and the enemy. When those soldiers who awoke the next morning found their companions dead, the army of Sennacherib left Jerusalem, left Judah, and went back to their country. When they returned, Sennacherib went into his temple to worship his God, and his sons assassinated him in his temple. But God stood in 722 BC between his people Judah and the invading army of Sennacherib, king of Assyria. The northern kingdom was no more. The northern kingdom is no more. They are called the 10 lost tribes of Israel. Isaiah began his prophetic ministry shortly before the events of 722 BC. Isaiah became a prophet of God to the kingdom of Judah about several years before the fall of Samaria. In Isaiah chapter 6, we find Isaiah's call by God. In the year that King Uzziah died, I was in the temple and I saw the Lord high high and lifted up. And his train filled the temple. And his glory was a glory that could not be beheld. And as I stood before God, Isaiah says, I trembled. I trembled before God, whom I was seeing in my vision. And I trembled because I was a sinner. I was a man of unclean lips. And I lived among a people of unclean lips. In the year that King Uzziah died, King Uzziah was a king of the kingdom of Judah. He was king in Jerusalem, but he was a king that had deserted God. He is a king that had stripped the temple and paid it in bribes to the treasury of the temple. He had paid in bribes to the king of Egypt to protect him. And he had nailed the doors of the temple shut, such that the priest could not go in and out and offer the sacrifices of incense within the temple. Uzziah was a king who was not a follower after David's own heart. He was an evil man. And so Isaiah, even though the doors of the temple are shut and nailed closed, he sees a vision of God high in the And he says, I'm a sinner. Here I am standing before God, and I'm a sinner. We know the story of how an angel took, with tongs from the fire of the altar, he took a lump of coal or ash or the wood, whatever, and he touched the tip of Isaiah's tongue. And he was cleansed. And God called him to be a prophet. God asked the question, who shall I send and who will go for me? To a people of unclean lips. And Isaiah said, send me, I'll go. For the next 60 years of his life, Isaiah ministered as a prophet of God to the kings of Judah. For the next 136 years, the kingdom of Judah continued to survive. It went from the time of the fall of Israel in 722 to the time when it, the kingdom of Judah, fell itself in 586 B.C., 137 years. During most of that time, or much of that time, Isaiah ministered. And he ministered, began his ministry, when Uzziah died, Hezekiah became king. Hezekiah was a king after David, like David. He's a king whose heart was following his father, David. He was a king whose heart was devoted to God. During his reign, he destroyed the temples of Baal. He opened up the temple of God in Jerusalem. Began, reinstituted the temple worship. He led the people in a Passover celebration, the first one that had been held since David's time. The Passover, which was supposed to have been celebrated every year was not celebrated after David died until the time of Hezekiah. He was a man who cleansed the land of idol worship. He was a man whom God blessed. He was a man who had a wonderful counselor by the name of Isaiah. Following Hezekiah, his son Manasseh became king. Next week, we're going to look at some of what Manasseh did and the other things and the other kings that followed. But from the time of Hezekiah to the time of the fall, there was nothing but a downhill slope, a downhill slide, because the people rejected God as king. In our story, we see words of Isaiah that came to him from God. Because as the people had rejected God as king, and as the time of David's descendants came to an end in 586 BC, when the kingdom of Judah fell, there was no longer a kingdom where a king could rule over the people of God. The promise that God had made to David seemed to be at an end. It seemed to all the world that God's promises were invalid. When the kingdom of Judah fell, there was no longer a place for a king. But Isaiah, when he knew of the fall of the kingdom of Israel, or of the kingdom of Judah, as he spoke to the people from God, Isaiah promised that there was one who was going to come that would be from the throne of David. That would be a king after David's own heart. We see that, we saw that this morning in Isaiah chapter 9, when there was going to be a son that was born whose name was going to be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And Isaiah spoke of one who was going to be a suffering servant, one who was going to save the world. Bill sang about Joseph as he said, "Why me?" About Mary, "Why her?" About a place, Bethlehem, "Why here?" And about a son, "Why him?" That God is going to save the world. Isaiah wrote, "Who has believed our message? And to whom has the world arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a dry root, a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by mankind. A man of suffering and familiar with pain, like one from whom people hide their faces. He was despised, and we held him in low esteem. But surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. And by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid upon him the sin of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before his shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, yet who of his generation protested? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was punished. He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit found in his mouth. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. And through the Lord, and though the Lord makes his life an offering for sin, he will see his offspring and prolong his days. And the Lord, and the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. After he has suffered, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong, because he poured out his life unto death and was numbered with the transgressors. For he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. Some 600 years before Jesus was born, before the king was born that was going to sit forever on the throne of David as God had promised him, Isaiah saw a vision. And Isaiah had a message that there was going to be a son born who was going to take the sins of the world upon himself. We come this week and we celebrate the birth of Jesus. We celebrate the life that was given to us through Jesus, the Son of God. We celebrate that gift of God. And it is right that we celebrate the coming. But in just a few months, the one who is born King of Kings is going to die on a cross for your sins and for mine. Trusting Jesus. Trusting Jesus. He is the one. And we have been called to trust him. Hezekiah trusted God when he was faced with that mighty army. We are faced with mighty armies around us, with sin all around us. And all we're called to do is trust Jesus. Trusting Jesus, that is all we have to do. He is our Savior, and he will provide for us. We trust your Son, Jesus. We thank you that throughout eternity you have had a plan for the salvation of man. That throughout eternity you have used men and women whom you have chosen to bring about this great miracle. And Father, we thank you for your Son, Jesus, and for his life, and for the life that he gives to us for the forgiveness of our sins. For it is in his name.